everyone. Welcome back to integralcalc.com. We're going to be talking about intervals of convergence today. And the problem that we're going to be using is the sum x minus 4 to the n divided by the cube root of n. So the first thing that we need to do when we're talking about intervals of convergence is the following. We substitute n plus 1 everywhere where we have n in our original function. So in this case, that would be here, the exponent in the numerator, and what's under the cube root in the denominator. So you can see we substituted n plus 1 for both of those here. And we take that whole thing and we divide by the original function. So everything down here is just the original function. And we find the limit of that whole thing, or I should say the absolute value of that whole thing. That's what these brackets here are for, absolute value. So we're finding the limit as n approaches infinity of the absolute value of this whole thing. So we write that out, and then we start simplifying. So what we're going to do is, instead of dividing this big fraction by this big fraction, we're going to divide the top fraction by the inverse, or we're going to multiply the top fraction by the inverse of the bottom fraction. So what you can see that I did here is flipped this bottom fraction here upside down. So this cube root of n went to the numerator over here, and the x minus 4 to the n went to the denominator over here. So we just flipped it upside down, and now we're multiplying instead of dividing. And that's the first process of simplification. So now what we're going to do is simplify. We can cancel out some of these x minus 4 terms, because as you can see, we have x minus 4 in the numerator and x minus 4 in the denominator. The one in the numerator is raised to the n plus 1. The one in the denominator is raised to the n. So we can cancel those. Remember that if you have something in the numerator of a fraction and in the denominator of a fraction, and the bases are the same but the exponents are different, you can add and subtract those things from each other and simplify. So what we do is we take the exponent in the numerator, the n plus 1, and we subtract the exponent in the denominator, n, and what we end up with, n plus 1 minus n, is just 1, which means that we're just left with x minus 4 to the power of 1 in the numerator, which makes sense, right? If we have this n plus 1 up here and just an n down here. So this x minus 4 is going to go completely away in the denominator, and we're going to be left with this x minus 4 to the 1 power in the numerator. So that's our next step of simplification. And then we're going to go ahead and take the x minus 4 and put it by itself and rearrange these fractions so that we have all of our n terms together in one fraction. Since everything here is multiplied together, I can do that. I can shift out the x minus 4 so I can kind of get my x's and my n's separate, which is a good tactic for simplifying in these kinds of problems. So now what I'm going to do is remove the x minus 4 completely from this absolute, from these absolute value brackets. The reason that I can do that is because this limit function here, we're taking the limit as n goes to infinity. So in terms of this limit, all we care about are n's. So we leave the n's inside, and we can move the x minus 4 outside. So when we move out the x minus 4, because it's within absolute value brackets, we have to leave the absolute value here on the x minus 4, but then we can just take the limit as n approaches infinity of this fraction here with the n's. So now we're going to go ahead and simplify further one quick step. Since both our numerator and our denominator inside here are cube roots, we can go ahead and take the cube root of the numerator divided by the denominator. So just a quick simplification step. And then now that we've done that, we can go ahead and plug in infinity for n and try to get an idea of what this whole thing is going to simplify to, this whole limit function here. So as you can imagine, if we have infinity divided by infinity plus 1, when you're out at infinity, it's, you know, 100 million, jillion, right? Adding plus 1 here isn't going to make much of a difference. What we're going to end up with is infinity over infinity. And if we take the cube root of infinity, we're still going to get infinity. And I know it's sometimes a difficult concept to grasp, but we have to be a little bit abstract. And when we think about an infinite number, even taking the cube root of it, the bigger you get, you're still going to have an infinite number. So this whole thing here will end up with infinity over infinity, which is going to simplify to one, because infinity divided by infinity, right, just gives you one. So we end up with the absolute value of x minus 4. This entire function, this limit of as n approaches infinity of this whole thing, is going to be 1, and we're going to end up with only the absolute value of x minus 4. That's what this simplifies to. So now, now that we have this absolute value of x minus 4, we need to find out where in this range our series is, or our power series, our function is going to converge. And the way that we do that is to find out where it's less than 1. So we set it to less than 1. And then to get rid of these absolute value brackets, we can transform this inequality here to be the quantity x minus 4 greater than negative 1 and less than 1. Whenever you have this absolute value and an inequality, you can take away the absolute value brackets as long as you put the opposite or the opposite sign of this quantity here on the other side. So since we have 1 here, we put negative 1 on the other side and we make this x minus 4 greater than. So now that we've done that, we just want to get x by itself in the middle here. So we add 4 to each of these three parts of the inequality, the negative 1, the x minus 4, and the 1, because adding 4 will get this x by itself. So when we do that, when we add 4 to the left-hand side here, we'll get 3. We get x by itself, and then we'd get 5 over here on the right. So we're looking at x greater than 3 and x less than 5, so on the range 3 to 5. So now we know that the series is going to converge between 3 and 5. We just have to check our endpoints 3 and 5 to determine whether the series will still converge at the exact point 3 and or at the exact point 5. And the way that we do that is by plugging in 3 and 5 separately to our original function. So let's go ahead and plug in 3 to our original function. We plug in 3 for x here, and we start simplifying. We're going to get negative 1 here. This 3 minus 4 is negative 1. We leave the n's alone, and now it comes down to different tests to determine whether or not this converges. And in this case, we're going to be looking at the alternating series test, because this negative 1 value, whenever you have a negative 1 raised to the power of n, you know that it's going to be on alternating series. This is your dead giveaway right here, and you can see alternating series, we have this negative 1. It doesn't particularly matter. In this example here, we have n minus 1, and in ours, we only have n. But this negative 1 raised to the power of n is your giveaway that you're talking about an alternating series. So in that case, when we have an alternating series, we need to test two things. One, that the limit as n approaches infinity of the series is equal to 0. I'll come back to this in a second. And also, that the limit as n approaches infinity is going to decrease. So the first thing, you may have noticed that these two functions here look slightly different than this above. What we do to test, just take the negative 1 here and replace it with 1. So that we have to do that in order to test. So if you replace this negative 1 with 1, we'll get 1 to the n, and 1 to the n is always going to be 1. So that's why we end up with 1 in the numerator here. We leave the cube root of n in the denominator. And now we're testing these two functions, first to make sure that it equals 0, and secondly to make sure that it decreases as n increases. So let's go ahead and test this first condition here, that the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 divided by the cube root of n is going to equal 0. And the way that we do that is by plugging in infinity for n, and when we do that, we're going to take the cube root of infinity. We're still going to have, like we discussed earlier, an infinite number. So we'll end up with 1 divided by infinity. And if you can imagine, 1 divided by the biggest number ever it's going to give you 0, right? 1 divided by 1 is 1. 1 divided by 10 is 0.1. That number gets lower and lower and lower and lower and lower. So the limit is going to be 0 because this is eventually going to reduce all the way down to 0. Well, not quite, but the limit is going to be 0. So 1 over infinity gives you 0. So yes, that condition is met. The limit as n approaches infinity of this function does in fact equal 0. So if both of these conditions are met, the series converges at 3. So we need to check this other one now. So we need to check whether or not as n gets larger, this whole function here decreases. So let's go ahead and plug in 2 test conditions to make sure. I'm going to plug in 8 for n just to make this work out nicely. If I plug in 8 for n, I end up with 1/2. If I plug in 27 for n, I'm going to end up with 1/3. So you can see as n goes from 8 to 27, as n increases, the overall value of the function is going to decrease. We're going to get 1/2 and then 1/3. So that's decreasing, which means this whole function is decreasing and that condition is met, which means the series does converge at 3. So we've checked that endpoint. Now we're just going to put that on hold, that information that it converges at 3. We're putting that on hold for a second, and we have to go check 5, because remember, x was between 3 and 5. So quickly, let's check 5 here. We plug in 5 for x, and when we simplify, we'll get back to that in a second. When we simplify, we end up with 5 minus 4. We get 1 to the n in the numerator. 1 to the n, no matter what n is, it's always going to be 1. So we just end up with 1 in the numerator here. Then, to simplify this further, I can change this cube root of n in the denominator to n to the 1/3, right? The square root of n is the same as n to the 1/2. Well, the cube root of n is the same as n to the 1/3. Whenever you end up with 1 divided by n to an exponent, you know that you're talking about a p-series test, because that's exactly what the p-series test looks like here. We end up with 1 divided by n to p. So in our case, 1/3 is going to be equal to p. You're always looking for the exponent. So whatever the exponent is what you set p equal to. So in our case, p equals 1/3. And the test, the p-series test, is if p is less than 1, or less than or equal to 1, then the series diverges at this point here. If it's greater than 1, then the series converges. In our case, 1/3 is less than 1, which means that our series diverges at the point 5. So everything between 3 and 5, our series is converging. We tested before to make sure that our the series at the point 3 converged, and in fact it did converge. But at this point, 5, it diverges, which means that our final answer looks like this. This is the way that we write, describe convergence when we're talking about the interval of convergence. Everything between 3 and 5 converges. The series also converges at the point 3, so we do this this hard bracket here. Since the series diverges at the point 5, we have the soft curve bracket here around 5. So this means converges at 3, all the way from 3 to 5, but diverges at the point 5 itself. So that's going to be our final answer. I hope that was helpful to you guys, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!